Hachette Audio presents Still Summer, written by Jacquelyn Mitchard, read by Susan Ericksen.
Day one. The three men finished with the small boat before nightfall. The painting had to be done quickly, and it was difficult. So afterward, they rested and smoked in the drawing dusk, their backs against a massive rock. The boat was called a Yola. They had spotted it bobbing near an island on a buoy in the natural harbor formed by the embrace of two small spits of land and hauled it ashore. With thick smears of black paint, they covered up its pale blue-gray color, its name, Bonita, and the white numbers of its registration. Over the lights, they spread a thinner coat. At sea, even if perchance they ran with lights to avoid a reef, this silty covering would make the lights indistinct and fickle, and someone might mistake them for a phosphorescent curiosity of the sea. Now they needed only to replace the engine with the larger one left for them the night before, beneath a tent of canvas concealed with branches and brush. The two older men had lived more than 40 years in the same village in Santo Domingo. The younger man, an American barely 20 years old, could understand only some of the words they said. He might have been fluent by now, but preferred not to be. Still, he could tell that they were talking about the way the sea always eventually gave up her fish, as well as other things. He heard the words for weather and soup. He knew these men as Ernesto and Carlo, but he suspected these were not their true names. For these jobs, the men lived for a few weeks each year in Honduras, at the homes of people whose names they were given. They were different people each time, cousins of acquaintances of men who knew these men by other names. At each place they stopped for food or rest, they would meet other people with no names. There seemed to be an endless supply of people who would forfeit names and memory for 50 American dollars. He had met them only once before. They disgusted him then. They terrified him now. He did not expect to meet them again. The young man drew in the sweet smoke, laid his head back, and thought of his sister. The last time he had seen her, she had been 7 years old, dressed for Halloween as a carousel horse in an outfit their mother had made of black tights and paper mache. He remembered his father saying that the young man did not need a costume to look like a freak. His mother pivoted on his father and defended him, a reflex on the part of her cub. But the young man knew that he had disgraced her, too, as his brother, still in high school, had honored her. He had failed to finish high school. His brother brought home trophies and fine grades. His own experiments with drugs and drunkenness had nearly put him in jail and cost his father considerable money and even more shame among his circle of wealthy friends. He did not like sports. After the time for playing baseball in the park was over, he had turned to quieter things. His mother had not minded, but his father spoke of him as a quitter. To the young man, the handsome, rough boys with their wide red mouths were embarrassing, almost frightening. He was not like the sons of his father's friends. Long ago, they had gone off to Brown or Michigan State. His brother would go to a fine college one day also. Still, his brother did love him, and his mother loved him no less than she loved his brother. His mother thought he would come out of the ways he had never expected to go. The young man sometimes believed this too. His thinking of it was interrupted when Ernesto said something conspiratorial to Carlo about offering a puff of their smoke to the owner of Bonita. This amused Carlo so much that he deliberately fell over on his back, laughing as only a servile man can, like a dog performing for its master. Carlo was stupid, which the young man did not believe made him any less dangerous than Ernesto. The owner of the little Yola sat some distance away, with his back also propped against a large rock. He made no comment on Ernesto's offer. because he was dead. Like a rare heron displaced from her environment, Olivia Montefalco high-stepped regally into the heat and blare of O'Hare International Airport. Though it was June, she wore a white wool suit with her high-heeled white sandals and huge diamond-stippled sunglasses. Those she passed were certain they had seen her before, perhaps in a magazine photograph. They fell back to make way. Oblivious to the stares from fellow travelers and haggard morning smokers, Olivia stood on her toes and scanned the ranks of limousines, SUVs, and police cars. Where was that huge thing Tracy drove? The last time she'd seen it, it had been filled to exhaustion by Cammy and about a dozen of her soccer mates, all chittering and smelling of sweaty socks. Olivia was amazed that Tracy could work full-time and cook for Jim and visit her parents and send letters and coach soccer as well. Perhaps now that Cammy was grown, she had a different car. Two skycaps trailed behind Olivia, like yoked oxen straining to push the teetering towers of Olivia's turquoise Hank van der Meene luggage. Olivia had shipped most of her belongings, but the bits and essentials that comforted her after 20 years in Italy came with her, in 14 matching pieces. Olivia bit her lip, a gesture that, when she was married to Franco, guaranteed jewelry within days, and wondered if Tracy had forgotten her. Olivia hadn't written for months and months, not since Tracy's flurry of phone calls and offerings of help during Franco's illness. She didn't wonder if being left at the airport would serve her right. That was the kind of pondering that Olivia censored. With a sure hand and her cousin Janice riding shotgun, Tracy piloted her huge van around the arrivals tier. "There she is! There's Olivia! Behind that weird luggage!" Holly Solvig shrieked from the back seat. "Wonder how much extra that cost. I've never seen someone with so much baggage." "We already knew that," Janice said dryly. Tracy remonstrated softly. "Jan, Halls, come on. If it is Olivia, it's Olivia. You knew she was wealthy." Olivia had returned to the United States only twice in 20 years, once for her brother's wedding, once for her father's funeral. Each time Holly and Tracy had come to fetch her had been the same. Olivia changed her entire appearance the way other women change the color of their nail polish. But since neither Holly nor Tracy Kyle changed, she never failed to recognize them. "I told you it was her, Trace," Holly repeated triumphantly. "Look, she sees us. She's giving the godmother wave." Tracy glanced back, nearly colliding with a sob. It was their wave, the American Sign Language letter Y, an extended forefinger and thumb. "Look at those sunglasses. She looks like Mario San Giacomo's mother at the country club pool in 1970. Now it's going to take a half hour to come back around again to get her." Holly felt like a fool. A 42-year-old woman making the Y sign out the back window of a van. "No way," Janice cried now. "Whoever that woman is, she's at least 10 years younger than we are." "But it is so to her," Holly insisted, reverting to adolescent language now, up on her knees and peering out the back window. "That's Olivia Senno, the Duchess Montefalco." "It's Countess," Tracy corrected her. "And you haven't seen her in 8 years, Halls." "She could be the Count of Monte Cristo for all I know," Holly said. "All I know is she's trying to get you to back up." Abruptly, Tracy braked, and through sheer General Motors muscle, with Holly yelling, "There's a very sick woman back there! We need to get her to help! Move!" backed her van through a bleeding horde of protesting vehicles toward Olivia. 25 years ago, the four of them had been inseparable. A fighting unit with black fishnet stockings under their navy plaid school uniforms, imitation black leather jackets from JCPenney thrown over their shoulders. Unholy innocence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.